Jeff, if you could just sort of go through some of the highlights as you were listening to what it was that the CEO was talking about there.
Well, he talked about the pilot's experience. That's one thing that really stands out there. He says this is a captain that had been flying with Germanwings and Lufthansa for about 10 years and had about 6,000 hours on the Airbus model. He also said that the plane was checked by Lufthansa technicians yesterday. That's important because in an investigation, one of the initial aspects of an investigation is looking at the maintenance record of a plane. So that was important as well. And he also talked about the final moments of the flight. They know that the max altitude was at 38,000 feet, and then the plane began a descent that lasted about 8 minutes. So all of that is information that is valuable in terms of this investigation, even before rescue teams get to this crash site, which they have yet to do. This is a mountainous region, and so that's going to make this rescue effort difficult. Of course, the French president has said that it is unlikely that any survivors will be found, but you still have to go to the scene. You have to look for survivors and look for evidence, including the plane's black boxes, also the plane's engines as well.
We know this was an Airbus A320, and in fact, Airbus has just released a statement moments ago talking about this particular aircraft involved in the accident. This statement says that this was delivered to from the production line in 1991, delivered to Lufthansa, and it had approximately 58,300 flight hours in some 46,700 flights. We heard the CEO talking about the safety record here of the A320. Let's go ahead and bring in Mark Rosenker, the former head of the NTSB. Mark, how common are these aircraft, the A320s, and what kind of safety record do these aircraft have?
They enjoy a very good safety record. There are a great number of them flying around the world. We're flying them in the United States. You'll recall that Sully brought his aircraft into the Hudson, and that aircraft survived. It did not break up. And so it's a very, very well-built aircraft. And as I said earlier, it does enjoy a positive safety record.
Mark, one of the things that we did hear from Thomas Winkelmann, the CEO of Germanwings, is that there are now Germanwing teams in Dusseldorf who have established a crisis center to notify both the families of their colleagues and passengers of that flight. Can you tell us a little bit about what those crisis centers are and what the response teams look like?
Well, they're a combination of activities. They are there to try to do whatever they possibly can to help the victims, the families of those that perished on board this aircraft. There will be people to help them with some funds. There will be people to help them with psychological issues. There will be even people brought in some religious support for those that that need that type of support to them as well. So they are working very hard to make sure that these victims, their families, are comforted as well as they possibly can during this very difficult period.
Mark, one of the other really solid pieces of information that we got out of that press conference is that the descent itself took 8 minutes. What does that mean?
Well, that didn't mean that it wasn't a catastrophic breakup in the air. This apparently was a failure in something. We don't know what it is yet. We will learn that when we get hold of the flight data recorders and the cockpit voice recorders. But 8 minutes is a relatively long period of time, so we will hear what the pilots are saying back and forth to each other, the checklists that they're going through, the kinds of mitigation techniques they're trying to use to try to get this airplane back to some area where they can land it. We'll learn a great deal from the cockpit voice recorders. The flight data recorders is going to tell us about the performance of the airplane. If, in fact, there was some kind of anomaly with an engine, or if, in fact, there was something with a structure in perhaps in the fuselage, we will learn all of these things once we are able to get hold of the flight data recorder and have them sent back to Paris for reading and analysis.
And, Mark, during that news conference, we heard the CEO switch from German to English when he was asked very specifically about whether or not the rest of the A320s should be grounded. He said that we're only 3 hours after this incident, and they are trying to obviously determine what exactly did go wrong. I'm wondering, what is the protocol when a crash like this happens? Have there been situations in the past where an airline will choose to ground the rest of those types of aircraft?
Well, first, we have to understand what happened. That gentleman is absolutely right. We are 3 hours into an accident investigation. We clearly do not know what happened there. Now, there are data points that we're going to be able to get from the actual aircraft itself, perhaps some data coming from the engine computers, perhaps some data coming from the ACARS, which is a computer system which is helping the aircraft perform and monitoring the performance of the aircraft. So there are data points right now that have probably gone to the dispatch area and are going back to the maintenance area of the airline. That has not been gathered up yet. It will be taken by the investigators as well, and everybody will be working together to try to understand what happened here. The BEA, which is going to lead this investigation, the French version of the NTSB, they're going to send a number of investigators who are skilled in areas like the power plant, the engine. They'll be sending somebody for the structures of the aircraft itself. They'll be sending somebody from operations. They'll be sending somebody, believe it or not, even from weather, because they'll want to make sure that the weather played absolutely no role in this accident. They'll also be having people coming from maintenance and looking at the maintenance records of the aircraft. All of these people working together with the airline and other investigative teams. I understand the Germans are going to be sending some investigators, and potentially, if invited, the NTSB may even send someone to assist in the investigation as well. At this point, that is not on the table.
Just to confirm something, actually, that that you brought up and that both the CEO of Germanwings spoke about, there are, in fact, investigators en route as we speak, and German Chancellor Angela Merkel will be at the crash site tomorrow, or is expected to be at a crash site at some point tomorrow. Jeff, do we still have you? I wanted to ask one thing just listening to Mark talk, it made me think about something that you had said, which is about the reliability of the aircraft, and actually, even despite these high-profile crashes, just how rare crashes are in air travel. And I was wondering if you could provide a little bit more context on that.
Well, sure. Anybody that you talk to in this industry will tell you this is still the safest form of travel, even with the year that commercial aviation has had. You have MH370, you have MH17, you have AirAsia, and now this. These are the big headlines, but the reality is air travel is safe as it has ever been. However, in 2014, there were more fatalities because of MH17 and because of MH370. But generally speaking, air travel is statistically the safest way to go.
You know, Mark had brought up just a moment ago, Jeff, the idea of weather. I'm curious, do we know what the weather conditions were when this plane went down?
Well, we don't at this point, but I'm sure investigators do. They have a better sense of what was going on atmospherically before this plane crash. And so that could be a factor. In fact, in terms of the rescue effort, in terms of getting to the scene, that will be a factor. And also nightfall. That is something that will come into play here as investigators try to make it to the scene in the next several hours. So they're racing against the clock to get to this very mountainous region of the French Alps.
And just to add to that, you know, some of the images that the audiences or that you guys are watching right now are from that staging area. These are the first teams from BEA, that is the French Aviation Authority, as they've set up for crash response, recovery, and trying to get more information about what exactly took place earlier this morning. Mark, if we still have you, I wanted to go back to something that we talked about a little bit earlier, which is that 8-minute descent. We're getting conflicting reports, but it appears like there was no actual pilot contact, possibly a mayday signal. But during those 8 minutes, is that common to be out of communication for that long?
It certainly, if they're working very hard to stabilize their aircraft, their business is to fly that airplane before they begin talking to the ground.
Sure.
They were working very hard, I am confident. Something, in fact, happened that needed to get them from the altitude that they were down to a lower altitude. What that was, we do not know. But these pilots were working hard to save the airplane.
And then that is presumably what the black box will tell us, they being so focused on stabilizing or trying to get on the right side of a situation.
Absolutely. The flight data recorders are a gold mine of information. The cockpit voice recorders, we're going to hear noises that were potentially in the cockpit. All the types of warning signals that may go off to tell the pilot what specifically may have gone wrong. We'll hear every single noise, and we will understand it. And when you put the two together, it will tell us exactly what happened here.
And, Mark, when we look at this particular Airbus A320, I'm looking at this statement from Airbus that talks about the number of flight hours, 58,300 flight hours in some 46,700 flights. In terms of aircraft use over the long term, how many more years would an aircraft like that, with that much use, have left? Would it be at the sort of end of its use?
Well, we're certainly at its above the midlife, and we're closing in on its retirement potentially. We always like to look at cycles rather than flight hours. Cycles are landings and takeoffs. That's where the real stress on the aircraft occurs. Cruising at altitude is relatively simple for the aircraft. But Jeff mentioned this earlier. Very, very rare to see an aircraft get into extremis while it's cruising. The vast majority of accidents occur in critical phases of flight, which is takeoff and landing.
And we should reiterate that this is the first major crash of a European budget airline in history. So this is, again, breaking very unfortunate but new ground. Thank you so much, Mark. We will keep you guys updated with what we know as we know it. Jeff, if we still have you on the line, I was wondering if I could ask just very, very quickly, is there any new information that you have heard regarding any American efforts to join this? I know there had been some discussion that because these are General Electric engines, there might be crews going out there. Anything at all in terms of our involvement?
Well, yeah, the engines, the makeup of the engines, of course, raised the possibility that the National Transportation Safety Board here in the U.S. would have some role in this investigation. But about an hour or so ago, I was told by an NTSB officials that they are not likely to join this investigation because the French will be leading it. But what happens in cases like this, the National Transportation Safety Board investigators, they stand by, they monitor what's happening, and they are always willing to assist if called upon. And so far in this case, they have not been called upon. The French are its equivalent of the National Transportation Safety Board. The BEA is very good at what they do as well. So they have all the technology needed to help figure out what went wrong here.
All right, a still developing situation. Jeff Pegues in Washington for us. Thank you.